Howdy doody! Today is Friday, the 5th of April. Greetings! Come and enjoy the Slavia Open 2024, the 7th edition, the 21 Syndrome, brought to you by the Stream Team. Live in the studio, we have my good self, Eric McAlpine from the UK, from Bulgaria, the tournament director, and our organizational maestro, Bojidar Iliev, aka Bojo, and from Italy, our technical guru, Gian Lazzaro Sana. Hi, guys.
Hi. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the show.
Hi, everyone.
And our special guest, the Nordic warrior, the ultimate Viking, channeling and harnessing the force of his ancestors. A man who embraces the challenge, loves the adventure, always looking to seek and destroy. The master pillager and plunderer, conquering the art of battle. The stealth and effortless accuracy of his PR blade, at a moment's notice, renders his foe into worthlessness. From Denmark, Mr. Jakob Rasmussen. Hi, Jakob.
Yeah, hi, guys. It's a pleasure being here.
Pleasure having you with us. This is round three. Match length is 21 points. Clock settings are 1 minute per game with an 8 seconds delay. Are you ready? When gladiators collide, Markus Doeve from Germany versus world champion Joseph Russel, USA, USA. Marcus, his first passion was chess, and having played some backgammon for around 30 years, he enjoys keeping himself sharp by playing and training against strong opponents like XG. Online, he plays most often at Dailygammon, but also on Galaxy and Heroes. Being a proud family man with three children, Markus has limited opportunities to play live tournament backgammon. Nevertheless, at the Zurich Open 2019, he finished third place in the Super Jackpot and runner-up in the Last Chance. Joe, his best achievements? Reigning champion, Slavia Open 2023. World champion, World Championships Monte Carlo 1989. Champion, California State Championship 2009. Champion, US Open 2015. Champion, Chery Blossom Championship 2017. Finalist, Nevada State Tournament 2008. Finalist, US Open 2009. Finalist, California State Championship 2015. Finalist, World Championships Monte Carlo 2016. Champions, with Team USA, WBIF World Team Championship 2019. I'd like to invite into the studio our events organizer, Bojo, to say a few words.
Thank you, Eric. Hello again to everyone that is watching this live stream match from Slavia Open round number three, Markus Doeve versus Joseph Russel, the defending champion. It's a very nice tournament so far. A lot of very interesting matches. Not in round three, I would say. In round number three, most matches have been pretty much one-sided. Some players are progressing to the 16 finals, like Sami Zutani from Japan, and Rory Pasker is there, first time Slavia Open finalist, and Karen Sarkisian, one of the top favorites, as well as the first ever champion, Arda from the OU, and other strong players like Giorgio Castellano. Also, we have three Balkan ladies in this later stage. Gyuzde Diptas from Turkey, Lenis Rantseva from Macedonia, and Zlatina Petrova from Bulgaria. So it's been very interesting so far, and I'm happy that we are getting into this interesting stage with more and more important matches. And also, I would like to remind all our viewers that this year we are running this prediction game for predicting the total PR of both players. And tonight is not going to be an exception. And we have the line 9.5. So, dear viewers, please write in the YouTube chat your predictions. We are going to give you like 10 up to 15 minutes after the beginning of the match before saying our predictions in the studio. And also we have a lot of predictions from our special guests today. So it's going to be exciting with many people taking part in the game. But yeah, do not miss the chance, because the winner of this prediction game, which is going to happen during every match until the finals, is going to get a spot in the pre-match studio before the Slavia Open final. So that is a good prize for the winner. And I do encourage all of you to write down your predictions on the YouTube chat right now.
Sounds like a plan. I would like to invite into the studio our technical guru, Gian Lazzaro, to say a few words.
Hi, Eric. I am looking forward to seeing this match. I remember the semi-final last year with Joe Russel, an incredible match. And I am very pleased to see him this evening.
Hear, hear. And without any further delay, I'd like to invite into the studio our special guest from Denmark, Grandmaster Jakob Rasmussen. Nice to have you with us, Jakob.
Thank you. Nice to be with you.
Yes. And what do you think about the clash coming up?
Actually, I don't know Markus. I'm looking very much forward to see. You're telling me that I should look for an even match, so I'm looking very much forward to see a hard-fought, a long match, hopefully not too one-sided.
Yes, that's right. We do like the excitement, anticipation of a well-contested match, and talking about that and being from Denmark yourself, Jakob, we've just had the Nordic Open. Could you share some of the tournament experiences and your own experiences with our audience?
Yeah, of course. I actually only played the UBC part of the Nordic Open this year. This was an Easter that was dedicated to being with my girlfriend, but I took out one day to play the UBC, and I was lucky enough to win it and playing a reasonable PR throughout the tournament, even though I made a very large blunder in the fifth game. I ended up around 3 PR, 1,000 above, I think.
Wow. Even with that, you still shot very, very low, of course. But with Super Grandmaster Mochi raising the bar and Dirk behind riding on his coattails, challenging him, the bar has been raised for excellence now, I feel, in backgammon at the highest levels.
Yeah, I agree that there are a few that are able to play at around 2.5, and then we are probably 20 people who are trying to achieve that, but it takes an immense amount of work to get there.
Wow, and you would know, playing lights out backgammon yourself, playing at just over 3 in recent times. And yeah, I think myself, Jakob, it bodes well. There's so many players that play strong now. It's really pushing the top of the mountain, so to speak, where everyone recognizes that, oh, there's a chance here for me to really, really show my stuff in how well I play backgammon. And more players seem to be rising to that challenge and want more. So I think over, you know, the next few years, backgammon's definitely going to be the winner. And we're going to see the base, I think, at the entry level of world class. I think we're going to see far more players
Yeah, yeah, I agree that the online community has moved the quality immensely. I had a 20-year break, and I think when I left around year 2000, the very good players were playing five-ish or something like that. And that has definitely improved during that period, with XG being a household piece of software and people playing that much online.
Yeah, and are you of the opinion that with obviously the extreme gammon and a little bit more time in recent years to have the opportunity to play a little bit more online, do you think they're the couple of catalysts in why we're seeing a raising of the bar across the board in backgammon?
Yes, yes, I do. I actually think that having systems like on Backgammon Galaxy, where it is, you get something for actually playing best and not only being lucky, has pushed people's ambition towards being the best instead of just being good and rolling.
Yes, very good point. You almost get a bit more of a reward for the time you've put in and at your requisite level. So yeah. I think that's a good idea for these kind of events. I think it would be not so good if it was across every tournament, because I think it's more about trying to involve as many as you can. But I think in specialized events and different tournaments, it's a very good thing, and it gives the very, very best players in our game the chance to shine and show what they can really do, because as we all know, backgammon is known as the cruelest game, and it's very, very unforgiving. And it really is a masochistic kind of head job, really, where if you can't deal with those kind of factors, you're going to struggle, I think, to raise your level of play, because unlike professional sport, you could play perfect zero and still get crushed over the backgammon board. That doesn't happen in pro sport.
But I come from a chess background, as Markus does, and from time to time, I think that there should probably be more incentive to play well as being lucky. But I understand that this would keep a lot of people out of the top tournaments. So I think it's fine as it is, and you could just elect to play those tournaments that you want.
Yeah, good point. And of course, I know you didn't have as much time to spend at the Nordic Open this year, but did you get a chance outside of the UBC to pop your head in and see what was going on?
During the main tournament, I mainly watched it from home. I was rooting for Thomas Muir, which is one of my friends and training partners, but he made it to the semifinals of the undefeated. And then lost, and then I sort of lost interest. I saw some of the matches, but not much. And of course, I know that the Norwegian that won, but I saw some of the matches, and but only, you know, on a superficial level. I didn't study into them.
Sure, and yes, you've obviously spoken of the exceptional Thomas Moore, Red Dynamite, who's incredible player in my view. His level of consistency of excellent performance rating is just mind-blowing. He's so steady and consistent at the highest level of the game, so it's no surprise to me that he managed to get to the semi-finals.
And Thomas and I will be at the World Team Championship this summer as well. We have an internal tournament to select the players for the national team, and I came in second, and Thomas, I believe, came in third. So the top seven qualified for playing.
Wow! So Team Denmark are ready and can't wait to be let loose in the event, and I think it's going to be very, very strong this year. I sense the last 2 or 3 years, there's been more international passion for teams to really send the best players to these events to challenge and try and grasp that title. Are you of a similar opinion yourself?
There are, to me, there are two kinds of tournaments. There are those tournaments where you really just want to play your best against the best, and those would be UBC and the world team championship and competitions as that. And then there are the others where you actually just want to win to get the prize.
Yes, yes, that's right. And just taking a quick look here. Well, I can't see Joe at the moment. Hopefully he'll be with us at some stage soon. And Bojo, what do you think about the contest coming up?
Yeah, Joe is already online, so they're just about to start the match very soon. As for the match, yeah, it's very, very even match, I would say. This is my expectation. Both players are very close as a performance rating, and I am not able to predict anything else except my game prediction, which I have already done and which I'm going to tell the people later. We will see. I mean, Russel, obviously the defending champion, as long as he's in the tournament, I would consider him a favorite in every match because he's with the crown and he has to defend. So yeah, everybody's trying to get it out of him, and we will see if Markus is going to succeed tonight. So they're both in the room already. So we are very, very close to the beginning of the match.
We are indeed. And while they set the table up or are due to, here we go. Looks like they're just beginning to get things going. So, yes, let's not waste any time. Let's get over there. Bojo, I shall leave you to do the honors. I'm really looking forward to this checkered challenge and cube conflict, the battle of the brain, a tenacious tussle. What's your decision? You sure about that? Is that your best foot forward? The art of war. Let the games begin. All right, so here we go. Round 3, Slavia Open 2024. Who's it going to be? World champion Russel or Mr. Markus Doeve? We're just about to find out. Okay, they're just going through the pleasantries here. And then we shall begin. Okay, yeah, just sending the signal. Yeah. Okay. And we're off. Here we go. Okay. We're starting. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. 62. First good decision. Now having a think about it, does he jump to 16 or cover more quadrants? He goes for the quadrants. Aha. Very reasonable. I'm predicting that's definitely going to be sent back. I think he's going to hit it because he can't play safe naturally. It's just a case of...
That looked a bit strange.
It did, I think, because...
It was perfect, was right?
It was right, yeah, because of the race. Yeah. I might have made myself the 4 point.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was definitely a consideration, and sometimes we can snooker ourselves or our thoughts a little bit when we move in twos and not do just the hit first and then take a look. I've done it so many times myself and blundered. That's why I know it's important to try and resist moving in twos. Okay. Nice start from both. Looking pretty sharp here. Early stages. Settling in. The girls! Double five. What do you think here, Jakob? Do you think quiet?
I'll play safe.
Yes, me too. Consolidates the race advantage.
Markus is ready for action.
Big time. Okay. Now is
and the... now, do we get rid of the checker on the ace? Or do we play completely safe?
Well, that's one option. There's also improvement play.
I'll play safe.
I play safe too. The improvement play is down to the 10 and slot the deuce.
It's a bit inflexible, the safe play, leaving the stripped points on 13 and on 10, but it's definitely good to consider it.
Yeah, but I think the rack on the other side, I'd be a little bit reluctant, I think, to take a punt at the chance here in slotting.
Slight preference to Gnu about the hit on the ace, but the two plays are very, very close.
Yeah. Okay, so, Bisto, always feels nice when you're struggling in position and you manage to find a play that improves and makes a point, takes the pressure off. Okay, now another tester. I don't see him offering anything up here. I think another safety play. What do you think, Jakob? Do you think safety as well?
Yes, but I'm unsure how, whether you want to clear the 10 now or should play to the 2. I think I have a small preference for this, yeah.
Yeah, breaks the contact and the 6 hold.
Yeah, we need to clear it anyway at some time, so we might as well do it now.
Yeah, it's a good option. I think many players will be put off by the 2 large stacks, but it seems to be the top play here. I think visually, many would prefer to play 8 to 2.
In the meantime, I have asked XG about the 3-4, and the hitting on the ace is clearly much the better play already.
Okay, so you have to make an improvement. Yes. Nice play, Boja.
Just not to strip all the points outside and to stack up 8 and 6 points.
Yes. Okay, so Markus ready and waiting, looking for the first slip on the banana skin here from Joe if he offers it up.
This must be another safe play, definitely.
Yeah, I think we have to respect the wheel on the other side.
Like this, nice.
Another very good roll, but he needs to make a point.
He does, but this is where we're teetering on the anticipation. Will he give the shot? Will he go safe? Will he roll a good number? Okay.
This is the shot.
It is indeed. And nothing else. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. Wow.
Looks like game over.
Big time. But the question is it game over or do you roll on?
Jakob, what do you think? Is it too good?
I don't know. I need to see Joe's roll before I can evaluate. But I think if he dances, we might want to take a roll, but it can't be that much too good.
Maybe also if he enters on 24, maybe even more, because he has to play the other number, which is highly likely to be another shot.
Yeah, I think so as well.
Dancing better than 24, I think. Okay. There is the cash.
Yeah,
it's
got to be, you've got to take a roll there, I think. It's just too advantageous and your opponent's struggling.
And mainly because of the high chances for getting another shot, for bringing back another checker, because even entering with deuce, still many of the numbers would give more shots.
Yeah, it's more fruit from the tree can be shaken loose and awkwardness in entering and playing somewhere else too. So, and weakness of board.
In the meantime, I would like to remind our viewers about the prediction game. They have one more game to write down in the YouTube chat the predictions about the total PR of both players. And again, the line for tonight's match is 9.5. So, dear viewers, please write in the chat over or under 9.5. You have a few minutes left to do it.
And Janazaro, what do you think about the start here from both the players?
Yes, are playing very precisely, so nothing to say. They're playing very well.
They are.
Oh, that's nice.
Very nice play, keeping options open. Likes the race advantage, so wants to be as effective in moving the checkers as possible.
And rewarded if he had played on autopilot and just put one on the 4 point, he would have given a shot now with the 1-6.
Yes, good spot, Jakob. Yes, definitely. Little miniature or small details like that make all the difference. Oh, and look at this, the even bigger reward. And yes, he's flown into double pass here, and we're going to be one apiece.
TOA 20 away.
Yes. And I like the statement of intent thus far from both players. Look to be playing at a very natural tempo, not too fast, not too slow, and both playing very well. Yeah, they look very comfortable. Well prepared for this third round match. Okay, then he thinks about the three. I'm not sure about, yes, I'm not keen on that, I must say. I think the 11 point is an asset in these early stages. Yeah, it's kind of a little bit superficial. You kind of...
Blue wasn't impressed.
Yeah, I think that's the platform for you to try and build, especially bearing on the 5 point. I think giving it up and leaving yourself vulnerable to the 5-6 from the bars, not quite as good.
So how do you play this? Is this anger and slotting?
Yeah. I love it, yes. Yes. Looks very, very good. I think it's only the anticipation of probably being hit that puts us off from this natural play sometimes. But once you've secured the 20 anchor, it's the only way to go.
Oh, that's natural.
Yes. Yeah.
And it's a mistake? Why is it a mistake?
Wow, that is a surprise.
He's giving timing to some sort of bad game-ish, but...
Yeah, I think you'll struggle to find a human that wouldn't hit there and make the 5 point.
Agreed.
Yeah, I think that's only a reserve for the bot and not a human player.
So what points do you take here?
Wow, this is this is really tough, isn't it? I think in a way, I like this more because it gives you more option. You need to get your back checkers into play. I think it's not quite as effective in blitzing away on the other side. I think you leave yourself more problems. This way, we've got a lot more numbers activated, and I think we can try and get into a better position. Yeah.
So are you trying to establish the 23-point angle, no, you're not, I see, Markus is not.
I think at least one of the checkers from the back, if not two, need to come out into quadrant two and three at some stage, so that would be more what I would be looking at personally. I could be wrong, of course, but that's what my iron vision sees.
But you were so far behind in the race, you should probably have taken the low point as you could. Two and four works better than three and four when you're far behind. And then you could have played with the other checkers.
It does, Grandmaster, but sometimes we can get transfixed into a game that we don't necessarily have to fall back on right now. the way I see it is he's got a 2-point board. It's too early to commit to the back game.
Yes, but it would keep option to open, I think.
Yeah, oh, definitely. Okay, so 52. I would just go after my own 5-point here, personally. Yep, I think this is the way to go. Okay, challenging role here for champion, world champion Russel.
Yeah, I played that as well.
Good play.
I like it a lot. There's the 5-point. He's ready for action. Yeah. Okay. Can Joe perform? Okay, he's got a, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, it goes for priming.
And now there will be...
And then matchup. And you will be hitting, I think, even though your timing looks a bit suspect.
I think anything but is a tremendous mistake.
Too strong the board.
Yeah, plus you've got to send him back and try and ruffle the feathers and see if you can change the course of action.
And his timing is still okay.
Yeah,
I think so too. This is all going to be the next 4 or 7 shakes is going to determine where the pathway takes us in this game. Because Joe's definitely vulnerable to hit and being sent back, but at the same time, Markus needs to try and get his checkers in the right place. Oh.
He took a good decision timing-wise, but not in this configuration, because he needed to get rid of this checker, which is going to hit him when he gets in the outfield.
Yes. Okay, that definitely helps Markus here, speeding Speedy Gonzalez from Joe here with his double fours. Okay.
Well, if Joe gets a 6, Markus is not going to be very happy.
Oh, I'm not sure about this. It's a bit not front loaded, but you're stripped and checkers past that point. I'll have had a little look-see just to make sure.
Okay, and now Joe is hoping for a dancing number and no 6 for Markus.
Yes.
Oh, nice.
Oh my, look at this, he's out.
And this is now very, very gammonish if Joe rolls and a deuce. Very gammonish.
It is.
Because he can pick up 4 checkers. And
was there a double before Joe's roll?
Ooh. Tough, I think. As well as this one, yeah.
It's so difficult to evaluate these positions.
I agree with you, Jakob, but both these fine gentlemen are really, more often than not, finding the best move, which is exceptional in this regard here, because it's very tough to play these kind of games. One misstep, just an innocuous non-hit move. Oh, 150 blunder. I hope I didn't do the commentator's curse there. Yeah.
What was the right to hit on the 4-point? Hit double?
To the double hit, yes.
Okay. Well, this is looking like a big advantage for Markus. I sense the cube's going to be flying across soon.
I don't know. Didn't he miss one?
I think so. But it's looking tough for Joe because he's now got 2 on the 23 and he's losing timing on this side.
Is Markus it too good now if he plays 7-4? Definitely not too good in this moment, I think.
I would ask the question here.
20 numbers and...
I think you have to cube here. I mean...
And 6-2 is making the bar.
What are we waiting for? Christmas?
That's 6-1.
Yeah, but that was a fantastic opportunity to ask the question. You've got your opponent just where you want them.
The pass must be crystal clear, so So the point is whether it was good.
Yes. Let's hope that it was that evaluation why he didn't ask the question.
Is the question.
Yes.
And
Oh my.
Oh, wow.
Wow, the power of position and asking the question at the right time. Even world champion Russel.
Double pass, double take.
No double take.
No double take.
We couldn't have a better variance one after another of different decisions.
And suddenly playing close to perfectly, now they have to improve their skills in order to get to under 9.5.
I agree with you, Bojo, but I'm always sensitive in games like that. They're so hard to play.
Yep.
I'm a lot more forgiving because I know from my own experiences, I've made one play without contact and it's been a massive blunder, according to XG. So they're very tough to get everything right when you're playing those back and forths and back games and turning and changing. Okay. 2-2, Desmond. All right. Anchors up. Partial escapage. Marcus, so safety that one, then think about the deuce. Plays itself.
Then go forward.
Yep. Yeah. Looks good. Yeah, I think he'll... Oh, okay.
Is that right?
Oh, I think you got a hit there. Yeah. Giving a bit too much impetus to your opponent to take advantage of your lack of aggression. Yeah, now he goes safe. And look at the different picture of this puzzle. Now Marcus has got a foothold. Now he's closer to asking the question with the cube. I think all because he was a bit too passive on that play with the 6-5. Now he's got a... Oh, mind you, he's back in it now. Helped out with the double 6, but Marcus has the position. Let's see how it pans out.
You might could have started clearing the midpoints with all the bloods in the Russell's board.
Good point, Jakob. Yes. Okay, so this will just be slotted up. Yeah, looks good. All right.
So double slot in the inner board.
I will have double slotted personally.
Okay, that's also fine.
Yeah. Yeah, sometimes.
Doesn't make that much of a difference.
Yeah. But sometimes players can be a bit more aware and sensitive to double slotting, fearing the phantom run and, I'll get a shot, I can't hit now. But more often than not, it doesn't happen that way.
Okay, this must be 13-6.
Yes. And
now the nines without the double threes.
Yeah, didn't manage to find it. Marcus squeaking forwards. Oh, this could be a good... Oh, is he enough ahead?
No, you're not clearing here, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right, Jakob. He's not enough ahead. It's too minuscule his race advantage. Three pips isn't enough to give up that contact. I agree with you, Jakob. No, I think it's right here. Keep the hold on the 21 and look for a bit more of an advantage.
I would clear 6 point. Keeping the 5 prime.
I agree with you, Bojo. Keep it pure. You can talk yourself into the wrong idea and make things worse here. Preserving 5 what?
Or this, yeah, this is another good option.
Good too. This is good too. Keeps the 5-1.
Take 5-3.
Yep. My play 2.
And I'll double.
Oh, yes, no doubt about that. Looks like a double take to me. And the players agree.
And what a 3-2.
Wow.
I would bring the checkers from the 8 point, yeah.
Yeah. I like this a lot. Yeah, I think it serves two objectives. You still got a lot the threats. More,
a lot more efficient for the bear off.
Yeah.
Honest?
Yeah, I like it for that reason. It gives yourself a two-way option. Blitzing and good for bear off. Wow. There's a gnat's whisker in this one. Can't predict who's going to win it. But a lot of anticipation and excitement to come. And what a shake there from world champion Russel. Takes off. Huge difference. Can he perform? Okay.
He needs to perform a lot because 6-5 and 6-4 is helping Markus a lot.
It is, and he looks very determined here to and go six, into the 4-2 lead. Yeah.
So is it 6-2 coming?
Oh. Not too bad. And if he rolls two more aces, but I think he's going to be fine. Yeah. Tough here. Oh, my
there you
goodness.
Go.
Oh, my goodness. Wow, what a
World
finish.
Championship rolling here.
Yes. And I must say, there's no better feeling than when you're in Marcus's position in bear off like that. It feels like, oh, I've lost the game. Bosh, double six. And then you go, no, I haven't. Take my double five.
No, he lost the game.
He did. But I think when you're on the other side and your opponent rolls a double six, you feel like it's not possible.
Yeah. Do you unstack? It seems natural.
It does seem natural. I think with the advantage of 4 point, this is a must. Try and press
home. It
seems
natural, making the five.
Yes, it does.
And the last one to 10, yeah?
Yeah, I think 10. Take a bit more risk. I play to 10, definitely. You need to keep quadrant three with action on it. If you come in, you've got the gap there. I think that could be damaging to your future potential and your chances.
Markus found the best play. Well played.
Well played, Markus. Don't listen to me.
And to me.
But I think opinions are good. Whether they're wrong or they're right, you're just expressing. I think it's healthy.
I think we're loving.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
We're not.
Okay, he waits.
So make the ace.
Yeah.
Yeah, since we didn't double, we probably could. Yeah. It looks like best option. It's annoying to be hit on the four now.
You don't really, the ace for sure.
I do as well. Two on the bar, you might pressurize and pick something else up on the way round without the extra risk. So I think this is a really good play.
And what's happening here? Do you think it's too good?
I would have doubled here after he entered with two out of the three checkers.
That would have been an unpleasant. Now, nice for Russell. I think he got free rolling here.
He did, and this is what can happen in backgammon, whether you get your timing right with the cubing or not. If you don't sense the moments and the opportunities to ask the question, things can very, very quickly turn around against you.
Well, but okay, it was not a drop, I believe. So actually, Markus is probably
not the second one. Ten in the zone.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it might be a trick. Oh, nice. Oh, is that right?
Oh, I'd have to take
looks
a look.
Good to me, definitely.
Yeah, I'd have to take a look.
Because he has the two checkers on the 10 point, he can play them freely. And at the same time, Markus is in an island position. So for me, it was definitely making the 9 point.
Yeah, and I think it can be a little bit of a misconception sometimes, Boja. When you cube, you don't want double pass. The equity in backgammon is in double take. And ooh, I know from my own. Oh, wow. Yeah. Yes. Forget my. This is real. Oh, my goodness. Yuck. Wow. Look at this. How ugly.
Okay. Yeah. Switching from 6-4.
Nah, I think I'll just move down to 9 and and keep contact there.
Yeah.
But it looks difficult to recreate the 6 point.
I think you're going to struggle to make your inner board. So in staying a little bit further back, you really reduce your chances to be potent in your home board. And really, the 11 is a worthless point. All it's doing is holding your opponent 17. But you're struggling time-wise.
That's my play.
Oh, no, if he does it like this, this is fine. If he does it this way, this is good, because now he's bearing in on the 6 point.
Is it okay? That's good.
I prefer this to the other.
Oh, and it's 6,000, according to Knut, better than playing to the 9.
So basically, a matter same of same. Personal preference.
Yeah, just how our I see it. Yes.
Okay, look at this now.
I'm much better now. Well seen.
Yeah, definitely.
Do we keep the 8 points, gentlemen?
Has he got two more to play?
Yes.
Yeah, I think you do.
I think you need to contact.
I like keeping the 8 point, yeah.
I think you have to, because all fives and sixes he has to move.
It would be annoying if he...
Oh, look at the difference!
Like that. He was right to do it.
Look at the difference in the play. He would have been on his bike. Oh my goodness. Unbelievable. Looks good. Now he's out. And
did he miss a double before the 6-5?
No, I don't think so.
But you expect the opponent to leave a shot and he has no 6 points already?
I think this is the end of it, though. 20 now shots the there. I think so. It's just too dangerous to consider fighting here. Oh, he
wow. He
good
took...
man. Wow.
He didn't miss a double.
You didn't miss a double, yes, definitely.
Yes. Yeah.
This, wow.
That's a bit too brave.
What a brave thing.
Yeah, it's so
now
easy.
We're just staying full Monty.
Oh, yes, no doubt. You go all in now.
Ah,
no. Could be right, but I will have gone for it a bit more. Yeah. And it's so easy to do. You can talk yourself into... I've done it many times. I've super blundered too many times to mention. You can easily talk yourself into the tape that's not there.
Those are the most set double fours. When you want to make a gammon to win 4 points, and then you have a 2-2-3 formation and you need to play safe.
Yes. But it looks like he's favorite to save. Whether he will is another question.
He's an absolute monster favorite to save it.
Yes. But being backgammon, we know there's more excitement to be had. Okay, there's the save. Yeah. Friday saver.
He rolls 2-0, but this is not likely.
Yeah. Well, after a technical brilliant start, then a tough back game, and now we're starting to settle in again. Both players trying to find their A game again. And what do you think overall, Jakob, about the match thus far?
Mixed, I think. Some strange technical decisions. Was that the second or third game where there was a lot of rather large errors and missed cubes but overall I think it's looking good. Hopefully they can readjust from a sort of shaky start here.
Yeah.
Okay. In the meantime, we closed the prediction game for today. And we can now share with our viewers the predictions in the studio. So we had Jakob Rasmussen predicting over 9.5, and the rest of the stream team, we all went under. And from our special guests, over 9.5 for Mislav Kovacic, Bakar Matikashvili, Elias Kritikos, Peter van Roy, Idu Levy, Daniel Sjorensen, Marcus Reinhardt and Rory Pasker, while under 9.5 was the prediction of Tim Cross, Karen Sarkisian, Florin Popa, Giorgio Castellano, and Bernhard Meyer. So it's very much split in two, and it's going to be very exciting to see who is going to get the points for the prediction game.
Indeed, very exciting, because there's so much more backgammon to be played, and I can sense that this is going to be a very, very competitive match, nip and tuck, toing and froing. On balance, I think we're going to see a lot of this through the course of this match. Okay. Yeah.
I like 22.
I like 22 as well. You'd really like the opportunity to make the 20 or the 22. This way, you're kind of only threatening to make potentially the 20.
Knu doesn't care.
Yeah, probably 5 millipoints difference or something.
Exactly.
Yes. Yeah. But it's always more interesting, the debating process with the minutiae involved. I think with some of my previous Chouette buddies, they always used to rib me a bit about minutiae gammon and, you know, my debating, where it was hardly any difference.
By the way, the 6-1 for Joe, it was interesting for me that he didn't go for the double hit. But according to GNU, it's a 0.001 difference.
There's going to be quite a few of those today, I feel.
Yes.
Yeah, we like it.
Are you playing here?
I think you have to. What else? I mean, where does the 4 go otherwise? I think having the full role, the question is, how do you hit? Do you bring the 4 down and hit with the 5? Or do you go this way? Is also an option. Yeah. This is the more pure way to do it.
Yeah.
I think you have to do something with your forward position. You're starting to become in danger the other way.
And he like has to hit again, I guess.
I would have hit, but this
okay,
is also
this is,
good.
This is good.
Yeah, because it joins up.
Many shot numbers.
Yeah, 6s, 7s, 8s. But if you do get away with it.
Especially if Russell doubles here.
Yeah, good point, Jakob. Okay,
he didn't.
He's going to send it back, though. Definitely the Elvis. Return to sender. Okay.
I would be surprised if this was a double already.
Look to it.
I think there's no harm in having a little look-see, just in case.
Oh, this is nasty. How do you play stuff like this? Like that?
Yeah, I think he has to.
$3.
Ah, okay. And what's the... Yeah.
Well, now there is an extra checker back, less checkers in the in the opponent's inner board point. Yeah, so much more likely this to be a good double. And it was a good double and a good take.
Yeah, well played to both. Felt that way.
Very, very small double, so for sure it was a no double, the one before.
Yes. But... reasonable to think of the speculation. Okay, and all to play or?
I go 6-5.
Yeah, but it probably doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
The important part is moving out.
Yes. Yes.
So what is this? Do we need to hit and then spread do the full spread like that? That was big to bid.
Might be a bit too big. Help. Yeah, I think
you don't want to date here.
Oh my goodness. Wow. Now he's really got a chance to change the course of action.
Good shots.
Beautiful shot. Wow, look at this. And I think you've got to make he's got one more to play. Yeah, you've got to make the 10. Nothing else.
Also a good shot.
Very good shot. Can he get away with it? No, he can't.
Okay. No double shot here for me. Yeah, that's my play.
Mine as well. Yeah, can he get away with it?
He managed to get out.
Now double shot. You can also make the four, but it looks right to hit.
Double shot for sure.
I think with the four back, I think you had to hit both of them there.
This is interesting.
This looks like the 4 point.
Yeah, but Joe's going to be in a bit of trouble here because I've just noticed he's only got fives out from the 21. Everything else is trapped. So this is going to be tough.
Well, now Markus is in trouble because he needs five and not 5-1.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. Good point, Bojo.
So it's easy to get away with two checkers than with five.
Yeah, definitely.
That is clever, but
no, you don't need to take any risk here. No, I mean, just go 6-3.
I agree with you, Bojo. Challenge him to perform from the 21.
Actually, only double fives is gonna hit both, but he needs to get out with five, so it's not dangerous at all having the two blots there. It's even better because if Markus slots something, there will be more shot hitting numbers. So definitely no need to make the 22. Yeah, well played.
Very well played. And there's the crackage in the package.
So as we said, more difficult to go out with five checkers.
Well, yes. Well, only four can go out from the back at the moment. I'm not counting the straggler on the 23.
Jakub, how do you like going crazy here? And
I'll hit it like that, and hope for one of the fours.
Yeah, it's one of the times that there isn't the request for the print song. Let's go crazy.
Yeah, GNU doesn't like the crazy play, but I think it has a lot of merits in it getting a good timing for the back game, which probably is making it complicated for GNU to estimate exactly.
Yeah.
As well as for XG, I would say.
But this is horrible for Markus.
I can just see the anti-jokers, just the build-up of pressure of anti-joker coming.
Oh, nice. I think you make the nine here.
Yeah. I like making nine.
Yeah, because you just crash your opponent so badly with fives now. So I love this move.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you keep it slotted, right?
Yeah.
Not looking good for Markus here. It's going to need a lot of help.
The one that's on the 3.2 to the ace. Just to put it somewhere where it makes some sort of sense.
Yeah, one was the preferred play by GNU. Very well well considered, Jakub.
Yeah, activate the number. Put it in play.
And this is the double hit, maybe. Okay, for sure it's a double hit. There's nothing else to play.
That's right.
And now Joe desperately needs to roll a six. He rolls a six, Markus, not Joe, I'm sorry.
Yes.
No six, but he can still keep the 4 point board.
He stays alive for this roll at least.
And now, six or no six? No six. So things are not going good for Markus.
No, and this is the crunchy nut cornflakes potential. Oh, and he just gets away with it. Wow.
Yeah, probably Markus was hoping Joe to roll a deuce and to recirculate the checker, but it didn't happen.
Yep.
And now it will.
Yes. But
not this one. This one was a builder for making five and six. The other one is what Markus wanted to get hit.
Oh, under pressure. Yeah.
Slot the 10.
Yes.
Good.
We like.
Oh, Joe Russell is squeezing out everything out of this.
And you might want to clear the 7 here. So clear the 7 to open the 5s.
Yeah.
Clear the 7 and open the 5s is very, very good, yeah.
I like it.
And it's the correct play again. Very well done, Mr. Rasmussen.
Yes, attention to detail. Deeper understanding. That's why he's a grandmaster.
Once you clear the 9 point in this position, it's already too late for trapping the checkers on the deuce.
Yeah.
Okay, some hope?
Well, for half the shake, and then I'm pretty sure we'll move both of those again. Yes. But at least
Yes, but I mean, gammon saving hope, I mean, not to win the game.
Oh, definitely. He's got a glimmer.
In order to win the game, he needs to make first 6 point and to slot the 5 point and then to hit to make the 5 point and then to consider. But this is very far for now.
Yeah, I think that's almost the impossible dream for me. You just want to gammon save and get the hell out of this game and move on to the next.
Oh, nice.
Yeah?
It's a good one, yeah.
Yeah, just scarper off the 21.
Don't hesitate. Just
just run away.
Efficiency.
Yeah, I think so. You've just been gifted a fantastic running roll, so run it away. Okay. Yeah, just simples. Yeah, either or. Up to how you feel and see it. Okay, he's off again. He's got any awkwardness? Don't think so. No dodgy numbers thus far. Can play everything. Okay, that opens up a maybe, but unlikely. And, oh, so much for the unlikely. Will he get hit? Yes, he does.
I will.
My, could we get some excitement at the end of this one?
And now make the 5 point, let your opponent roll 4-1 after slotting the 4 point, roll a deuce, bringing the other checker back. And yeah, that's pretty much how it works.
Oh, and he's got other ideas.
That's automatic.
Oh, and he hits him back. Oh my, look at this.
Yeah, but 5 point is gone, so Markus cannot win the game anymore. Even
5-1, then we hit the second checker, then we win from there.
Exactly, and then Black almost never played again.
Yeah, but okay, there is not going to be so much dancing potential.
Yes.
And we just dump it here.
Yeah, you're no,
we don't, actually.
Okay, gammon safe.
Yes.
Easy winning.
Indeed.
I guess everybody happy in this game. Joe is going to get the 2 points and Markus is not going to lose 4 points.
That's right.
Unless Markus performs now with a couple of double sixes.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's the end of that then.
That was a nice game. I like very much.
I agree.
Yeah, really swingy and back and forth and decisions and awkwardness. Yeah, and Jan Lazaro, what's your thoughts at the moment on the match?
I think that they played well, apart some moments in that, I don't remember if it was that third game, the big game, some Cuba actions not very good, the same type of errors that I usually make, but the difference is that I think about making the error. They did it without thinking. Oh. Quite astonishing, but it happens.
It does indeed, and I sense more excitement to come from these two players as they're jousting away, trying to gain a bigger foothold in this 21-point match. Yes, and Jakob, what's your thoughts? How can some of the not as strong play? Oh, yeah. Oh, sorry. Correction. Hold on. Oh. We had, maybe something, maybe not so good giving up the mid. Separating the armies, maybe.
That looks dangerous moving forward, but this is horrible as well. So are we just hitting and making the 9 point? Or the 8 point, sorry?
I would make the 8. Yeah.
But it might
or the 9. 9 is good too. But make something over there for your configuration. Okay, that helps a lot. Yeah. Are
we still in docking territory?
Very close, isn't it, here with the threats?
3 versus 1 and 3 behind. And if we make something, I might just... And this is this a bar? Is this the 4?
I would do this for
the lot of plus.
Yeah, he can. It's not bad, I suppose. Well, there's about 3 or 4 different moves here. Make the 4, make the 8 and safety, make the butt. Yeah, there's quite a few different options.
Safety seems sort of weak, but it might be. This is difficult.
It's very difficult. There's something about this. I don't know if it's because
the
I like
the 4 looks like a permanent asset. And
it does.
Goes wrong when you're not hit.
Yeah, that's the thing I like about it. If you're not hit, you're in such a good position. Might not be right, of course, but could be something a bit safer.
What do we give? We're giving 13 numbers on that side. Oh, doesn't look right.
Well, this I think is not as good as making the 4 because you're hitting deeper and leaving a block where you don't want it to be.
Gnu makes the 4 with the bar coming second. Mm-hmm. But what happens now? Oh.
It just felt right because of the upside.
What is this?
Oh.
What happens here? Oh.
Dropped. Yeah, I didn't even have enough time to pay attention there. Okay. He's back in. 7-5. Getting more interesting. Lots of good
double hitting here.
Double hitting.
Yeah.
This must be a cube, right?
So we are deep.
Oh, it's close, isn't it? It's borderline. I think it's just a little bit under, but I wouldn't grumble if you did. Just because it's where the checker is from the deuce. I would wait.
Well, he's 0-2 in a like the score, and there are blots, 2 blots and 1 checker on the bar.
It looks a lot like the classic double 5 with just an improvement and shaking from there a bit more wood. I think you just have enough, but I think I'll grab it.
1 more checker in the zone.
Yeah, exactly.
Or if that checker wasn't on 23 and it was on 20 or 21, then I would cube. But because it's on 23, I'm just...
Now we're just starting to hit. We're hitting an 11, I think.
Yeah.
For me, it was a clear cube. But usually I am wrong.
Well, it's good to have so many different opinions here. I think that's nice.
Two more spares on the 8 point... in comparison with the classical double 5 with the checker on the deuce point.
There was missed doubles.
Yeah. Yeah. A few missed opportunities there. But now only 1 away. 7-6 to 21 points. Getting excited.
Okay, it was a solid cube before the 6-1.
Okay. Yeah.
Slow.
Okay.
My reference position worked.
22 is fine.
Well done, John Ezra. Yeah. I think you've got to do something somewhere. This for me is a little bit too much of a sacrifice. I think
but
you have to do something.
So this might be fine.
Yeah, this is it's something, but just don't come in and do nothing, I think is important here. Okay, that's pretty good. Now the question is,
4 and 22.
that's what it looks like thus far.
Okay, talking about the reference position, back to the 6-1. Yeah. If the score was 0-0, and if there was no blot for Joe on the 11th point, and this checker was on the 8th point, so three pips less disadvantage, it would have been a borderline cube.
Okay.
Okay.
I like this one.
I like it too. Doing two good things on both sides of the board. This is one good thing, but you've advanced nicely. But I think this doesn't apply enough pressure on both sides of the board. You're still going to struggle to fill in the 5 and the 4. No spare on the 8. Double 4. 6-1.
That's a nice squish play.
Yeah, it
this is.
This
is also good because of the stripped midpoint, so you cannot really get hit back and suffer out of it.
Oh. Yeah, I think I just like Jakob's play as well. There's this me too. This just looks like it's got build potential, growth potential. You can put your checkers in good places.
And you keep the pressure on the blot on 9 point, but on the other hand, he can cover it with a 4.
Yeah, and then
your back checkers. Yeah, that's the play. He found it.
Everything else is a blunder.
Big one.
Yes, welcome to the blunderbuss. Okay.
And the two players are very far from 9.5.
Bit so, but they're finding their game again. I can see them whittling this down. It's just a few little awkward moments here and there. Bit of normalization.
I don't know how it is. 6 for the 2 first, and then what?
Is it all to play?
Like that? Yeah, perhaps.
What's he got? 4. I would keep the 11, actually. No, I would have come down from the midpoint. That. Yeah, it I think you need... I think you need the effective 6, so I'd have kept the 11, I think.
Oh, he'll give free shot, 3-5-5 for more. That's nice, actually.
Very nice. Can he get the fan? Okay, that's very nice too.
Well, the question is not can he get the fan, the question is can he get the 4?
That's right.
But he doesn't need to, because he doubles now.
Yep, I agree with Jakob, and he's got the time. He's got him where he wants.
Would you drop this
one?
Yeah,
double before. I was just looking at the 1-1 move.
Ah.
Is it double? Nope.
No, no way this is a drop. No way.
No, it's a quite easy take, according to Knut.
Yeah, because of the... The difficulty in rolling the 4s and getting away. Just not enough time to do that efficiently.
Well, it's a very close decision, so let's ask XG.
Yeah,
and
sounds like...
XG says a huge pass. Wow, such a big one.
Do you want to be right by XG or right by GNU?
I'll buy the pass.
XG says a big pass and... And
yeah, just the look ahead value.
I
agree. Yeah, just look ahead value. It's at a low ply, so it doesn't understand what's really going on, where XG looks much further ahead and goes, nope, you can't take this. Get out the game.
Well, what you said about GNU is completely valid for myself.
Yep.
I would have taken for sure with... those two checkers being able to object for
2 on the bar is just so unpleasant, and with so many gammons.
It is. True. It is, and from a 37%,
7% gammons.
It feels so uncomfortable, doesn't it? You don't, even if it is a take, you just all your instincts are saying, "Oh no, I don't want to carry on in this game." Wow. Look at this. Hot. Hot. Yeah. Okay, so just, yeah, that's really putting the cat amongst the pigeons. Very difficult here for Markus, stuck behind the power of world champion Russell 6 prime here. I wonder what he can come up with. Can he make some plays where he may have a chance?
I think this is a good play because he's killing his sixes this way. So gaining a little bit of timing.
Good point. Yes. That's struggling here. What's the roll going to be? Okay, he's in.
Good roll, but he keeps... Okay.
Oh, dear. After
double flash, it's not that bad.
Yeah. Let's see what he can do. And that's the first performance.
So six numbers.
Yes. Can he get away with it? Is the question.
And no. There's one of them.
And there's the heat. Oh my goodness. Hold on to your hats, ladies and gentlemen. Here comes the cube. Why did. Oh, mind you, he's got four off. My apologies. I didn't see. Yeah. Yeah, he's got four off.
So it's four. Hold.
And but now is the
now question. We're moving there.
2, 4, 6, 8, 10. It's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11. Yeah, four off.
It is a double for
yeah,
sure.
It is a double.
Yeah, you must. You must.
But it's a take. Is it a take? Probably not.
Probably not. Just if, times against you, I think.
If it is not a take, this one, it means he missed the double the roll before.
Ah. Just because if you fan once, can you still have the chance to win?
No, I think he should take this.
Oh, okay.
The 6 point is open.
Yeah, but it doesn't really matter. Yeah,
it's just the timing that if you just fan on that first shake, it's more or less all your winning chances just drop down by so much. It's not worth taking the chance. Yeah. Okay, so a very, very well-timed recube by Markus. A slight misstep by Mr. Russell. And all of a sudden, it's looking like we might have a different complexion in this match.
If the cube was in the center, it is a very small pass. And of course, the redouble is much bigger.
Yeah. Too much extra value in recube take. Okay. Yeah, and it's superficial. There's many players that would take in the same position. You can easily talk yourself into taking, but once you recognize there's not that many rolls that leave a shot, he's got the solid five board and some spares, and if he rolls and you don't come in immediately, I think you just lose too many chances to win the game. And there it is.
And he had the gap on the ace point, which was very, very bad.
Ah, good point, Jan Lazaro, yes.
Is that right? No, 27 in this position, I think.
Yeah, I agree with you, Jakob. Just not quite enough ammunition in the zone, and you give yourself a two-way option on both sides to improve.
Okay, if he didn't have the gap on the ace point, XG says, it's a monster take, doesn't matter if it's double or redouble.
Okay.
Ah.
So actually, this is the main key, the gap on the ace point.
But that makes positions. Sense.
Yeah.
Big difference.
Indeed.
And if it's a single checker, it's borderline pass the redouble. And it's a big take even with one checker on the ace point.
Ooh. Okay, so we've got some blasting going on here. And? Yeah, close call, I think, between that and jogging one more step forward onto the 22. Yeah. And? Ooh, not bad. Ducks. Yeah.
And Kimo.
Yeah.
Next game.
Yeah. Yeah. And it seems that Markus has got himself into a nice little groove here. After that recube. A little bit of momentum, building the pressure.
Don't you make the both points, inner points, after he ran? I think you do. But then.
Yeah, I think so as well. You just want to have your inner board ready for action. This way it kind of gives the opponent more chance to get away with things. So I like your play, Jakob. Is it just point here?
You can also run, but it seems unpleasant, but this is not nice either.
Yeah, it's a tough call, isn't it, I think? You don't want to give up the midpoint. It's a bit too early. Hitting loose, I wasn't as much in favour of. Point or run, I think.
Starting the fight. That's what he did, but it was not right.
And 11 and 8 here must be the play.
Yep. Okay. And
definitely.
Yep, just stays out of harm's way. Look
okay,
for brighter
likes
days.
Hitting on the ace because of the blots in the opponent's inner board.
Okay.
Was no hitting on the ace?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, HP. What's in the nothing is happening here.
Yeah.
Probably not, but
yeah, just needs one more improvement, I think.
But now he needs to pay to see the next. Come on, man.
Yeah. Yeah, market blown, looks like. He's got to take the other one out, yeah. Play on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
XG does hit on the ace big time.
Yeah. Okay. Just getting his configuration ready for more action. Make the point. Yeah. Gammon's going up. And?
This was a good 4.
Yeah, just nice and quiet. Yes.
First 4 and then double 6s, and not first double 6s and then 4. This is the wrong game plan. Wrong role plan.
Yeah, this or 3-2. Happy with both. Okay.
Another.
Ooh. Yes, it's the tantalizing fan. Oh, yes, he's in, ready. What can he do here?
I think we'll just roll on.
No question about that. Too many favorable numbers, and his little meek blot is just waiting to be blitzed out there. Or pointed on, I should say. You're not going to blitz. Yeah. And looking very solid favorite for Gammon. Yeah. Joe's going to need quite a bit of assistance here. Otherwise, it could be a 4-point breaker for Markus.
Only 2. He didn't double.
Only 2.
Yeah, only 2. Oh, my apologies. Yes. Yes. Forgot about that. And? Yeah. Well, I don't think you can save it. So, next best approach is try and get something ready, but I don't think you're going to get the shot either. So, tough to work out.
I think he has to go for saving it through doubles. I mean, this is more likely than getting a shot, hitting, closing, etc., etc.
Oh yes, no doubt about that.
Okay, now there are 8 shot living numbers.
Yeah.
Just not so bad.
Yeah, there's a glimmer of hope in the distance.
and one number that is not going to solve the problem. Not one of those.
Yes.
Markus on fire.
He is, and the wind is definitely in the sails, and he's clocking up the points at the same time he's finding that forward momentum. So he's applying really good pressure here to world champion Russel. But after the escapades of 2023, we can never write this great man off.
Never.
Yeah. The heart of a lion.
23 and 89.
That's right. That's right.
2-1 is not going to help, definitely.
Yeah.
So, okay. five points lead.
Yes.
Yeah.
And for the first time, Mr. Doeve takes a very decent lead. Yeah. And two more. Yeah, it's the point or run around the corner. You may fancy that with the 5-point breaker. Get off the hot spot. Which he has done. Okay, can he survive the blitz?
This is the end of the game unless he goes for the G.
I agree with you, Bojo. Bye-bye game. Yeah. Okay. Swift response from Russel. And
ooh.
Double twos. Anything that makes the rack.
Fuck.
Yeah. Okay. It's got to be.
Yeah, behind in the match, this is a clear double.
I agree.
I'll double 0-0 as well with rack versus nothing and four blots and so many chances to hit and win a gammon.
Me too. Just can't resist. Oh, no. No. Why? What are we waiting for? Christmas? Birthday?
I don't understand.
Anniversary?
Jakob, what do you think?
Yeah, I don't.
I would not have even blinked.
Now we have.
Yeah, but this is so much deeper.
Unless you know something, no.
This is too good. Already.
It was the one before. That was the moment. It's the...
Oh, it's a 1.5 blunder to 130 not to double. It's double pass, the roll before.
Yeah, it's the one bullet sniper, isn't it? You've got one bullet in the gun as a sniper, and you've got to finish off your opponent with that one bullet. You've got to time it just right. If you don't, you're going to pay the price.
And as predicted, it was not only a double, but it was a big, big pass.
Wow.
But what seems to be happening here for money, it looks like you can pick it up, don't you?
Yeah.
30...
What a shape there by Markus, priming in the two checkers on 24 in making the bat. Yes.
Bye bye. 24.
Yep. And
it's sweet having this prime, but not this time. A missed double by Markus before the 6-5. According to GNU.
Yeah, but I sense he's finding a better groove all of a sudden. There's a bit more snap and wiggle about his game here.
From what I can see, the two players are really interested in giving the prediction game points to Jakob.
I like the cooperation.
I like the fact you've done a deal. It's brilliant.
Yeah,
fantastic. But this is what makes the prediction game so much fun. It's oscillating all the time. You don't know where it's going to land. And is it going to go down? Is it going to go up? What goes down must go up. What goes up must come down.
Two of our viewers have predicted over 9.5. Those are Daniel Zakharyev and Zlatina Petrova. And Zlatina is the leader on the competition so far. So it's going to be interesting if she can get another point.
Yes. Wow. Doing very well. And
Toledo played for under.
Yes. And we're getting closer to more action. What is going to happen? I can't wait. Okay, so jockeying for position here.
I love that. No, but they don't.
Ooh. Wow, I didn't even see. Oh, was it a choice of whether to hit or make the 20?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tough, to make is better than to slot. This is almost always this way.
Yeah, I think just the lack of ammunition, I think. Can't really blitz away and you can make your opponents 5 point or 20 points. So that's definitely the better way to go.
Mm.
Wow.
Ten away.
Ooh, 2.6.
We'll ship it and let Russell figure out what's happening.
I love the way you expressed it there, Jakob. Yes, I
he
agree with
probably
you.
Has to take, but this. Oh,
I agree with you.
Well, in order someone to has to take, someone else has to double first.
Yeah,
that's right. The,
maybe now, it just, now it's now
yeah,
too late.
It's a pass. Yes.
Oh, that wasn't a double before. Nice play from a.
Excellent play. Yes, probing, looking. I sense the forces with Markus here. I think world champion Russell was going to have to bring one of his famous rabbits out of the hat here.
Small no double before the 5-4 SXG, small one.
Oh,
and it's mainly because of the score.
Yeah. But
what are we doing here? Playing 22 and 8 or jumping to the 17 point?
22 and 8 for me.
22 and 8 for me too.
Yeah. Okay. This is looking good for Joe. If he gets the fan, I think the cube will come flying.
I think that he should have gone to the 20 points.
I think so too. Now he doesn't have anything.
Because he replaced the bar point where he was blocking his opponent's sixes with 3 points where he's blocking his deuces. So I don't think it was a good trade.
Oh, that's a nice shake.
It's better. Very nice shake.
It's a bit
look at that
for the timing. Ooh, and that's also a nice shake.
Oh, and
again,
Russell
doesn't have anything.
Oh, and that's another
one.
Yeah, if you can get away with it.
How masterful.
Yes.
So now what's happening?
Well, it's one of those you've got to do something you don't want to do, which is this.
Ooh.
You're not leaving, I think.
If he leaves him alone, do you not get snookered on the 24?
No, if you don't hit, you bring two in. No way you break the midpoint.
Yeah,
midpoint is important here.
I like the 8 point, but they look nice on 3 and 4. I agree. Yeah, that's probably okay.
Yep, he's gone for the duplicatus hit to try and get off the 24 with the two blots in the outfield.
Can you take a double if you hit on 24?
I think
after the play
in Markus's position,
can you take this one?
I don't think you can. I think I would drop this. Yeah. And I would be wrong. Wow. Wow. Yeah. Just shows you, doesn't it? You can't get every decision right. I would have been hopeless there. Yes.
So breaking the 8 point, correct by far. Followed by hitting on the ace and two down is a very, very big blunder. Main problem with hitting the ace was that there was no single checker to cover.
This looks a bit strange. Shouldn't we make 11 here? Are we making the 5? I would like make 4 and 11, but...
4 and 11 says GNU. Not big difference, 22 melee points.
Yep.
Nice.
And definitely. Now...
Well, he's...
We'll just make the 5 and put an extra checker there.
Yeah.
The question is, how big is the danger for the backman?
I agree with Jakob.
Oh!
This is a panic hit to me. You've got your opponent with the straggler exactly where you want them to be. Your checker on 24 is in no real danger. So it's an overhit for me.
Yes.
Because you're dragging your opponent forward for no gain other than putting him on the roof.
And even if the things go good his way, he didn't have many spare checkers to cover and to make more points.
Yeah.
Everybody. Yes.
I mean, if you look at the position, where would you prefer your opponent to be after the roll? Stuck on 24 or on 20, 23, 22 or 21? I mean, if you asked beforehand, you'd say, well, I want him to stay on the 24. So leave him there.
Considering the prediction game, I like very much this boring racing game.
Yes, brings a little bit more parity to the PR.
And now it's over.
It is indeed.
It's over.
Is it completely over? It was.
It was, yeah. 12 is a bit too much. Much. Yeah.
A not enough time. Something like that.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to get your opponent too far away just with a hopeless race.
Yes. Good point, Bojo.
Right. I would have played 9 and 3.
I would have played 9 and 3 as well. I think you have to start trying to look to be a little bit more aggressive here and not let your opponent's momentum overwhelm you here. Yeah.
Do the anchor or need to run here? The anchor game looks like it's got to give the next roll anyway.
Yeah, it does. But another way, if he runs out, still ugly.
Wow. Yeah, this awkward. 30 to me, race.
To yeah, me, why not? This was the better one.
Yeah, you create better timing and other factors to consider.
Too much ahead in the race in order to make the 22 anchor against very few checkers. So yeah. It was either running or going to the 20 and waiting to anchor up there.
Yeah. Okay. And it comes forward. I think this one is going to be better than the previous one. A little bit too static. Okay, and is he taking a look-see? Well, let's see if he can perform. Mini one here. And, wow, snake eyes. Makes the rack. And, okay, releases the checker. Still in position. And he's in.
Oh, nice shot.
Very nice shot.
Pointing on 2 for the tempo hit here.
Yeah.
Pointing, yes. Not slow, not loose hit. Yeah.
Nope. Yeah, this is the one.
And here making the 10 point, playing safe. Yeah, yeah, good.
I like it.
Oh. This was a brilliant.
Wow. That is
slightly above average.
That is huge, and he's going to be cubing here. Oh, maybe not. I would have doubled in a heartbeat there.
I would have doubled myself. So.
There's no way I'd let the man see the roll there for free.
And that's also... No,
Does he not like his race advantage here?
3 points.
Is nearly 40 pip advantage.
But it probably doesn't matter that much, but still, it's worth looking at. He has so many pips ahead, so.
And his point is on 11, which is 7 away from the anchor.
Yeah, it's nice.
If it was on 10, then it would be more difficult. But on 11, without a direct shot, I mean, he should have.
There is a point in arguing for going to get 4 away exactly, but I think it's. Oh, nice.
Maybe he is going for that. Maybe he prefers, I don't mind sacrificing a bit of equity in the race. Ooh, if I can land on 4. Ooh, yes.
Joe finds the heat.
Can he encourage the miss? Is the question.
Yeah. Well, Markus needs to enter with a deuce and to cover his bluff on the ace point.
Okay, next game.
Game over.
It is.
Oh, there's a lot of miss there. And they were takes, I guess. Take.
Yeah.
They were only small. They were only small doubles, but still.
Small, for sure small, because I mean, he's still leading by a couple of points, but you don't let your market get lost this easy when you have such a big lead, even though he lost the game. So. Markus is happy now. He didn't double for sure, but otherwise.
But that's not how it works.
I agree with Jakob. The stars would have aligned. If the stars would have aligned differently, you can't hedge and keep the stars and then not move, and then the stars move naturally. So yeah. I'm in Jakob's camp.
So am I.
Very nice point. Yes. Yeah, and. Okay, chances again. He's got to move one of these. He's not going to slot the deuce, so that's the logical option. Now he can send it back.
8 point.
Yes.
Yeah, of course.
Now he's creeping closer to the doubling window.
21 and 23, perhaps.
I like it.
Oh, we're going all the way out.
I'm not so keen on that. No. Self-priming. Now it's trouble. Big trouble. Just because of the self-priming, now the cube is going to come.
But shouldn't it have been done the roll before?
Yes. Yes. You can't miss your moments, especially when you're behind in backgammon. And I'm not saying I'll get everything right, but
Here it's worth considering double hitting. Some people don't like doubling when with two on the roof.
Good point, Jakob. And I think he's got no choice. Other. Yeah, I think he didn't have much choice there.
But not
champion Russel. Wow, look at this. Was there a bit of enticing him in with the cube? Maybe, maybe not. Wow. Look at this. So he's got to make the 7 and then think about the
16, I think.
16 and I like this. I like your play, Jakob. That's the best to cover all quadrants and be in a good position.
That looks cramped.
It looks a bit too front happy. I prefer the other one. Because if you get away with it, your winning chance just really goes up a lot here. Gammon's very good anyway, but just a bit too forward for my
team. Now we're just flashing away.
We are. Not much choice. And here comes the reverse slash. Yeah. And?
Ooh.
Ooh, la la. Maybe. Oh my goodness, look at this.
What an after sequence.
Yes, and oh my goodness, it's happening.
Oh, how do we play this? Are we hitting on the deuce and then playing to 23 or hitting double or what are we doing?
Yeah, I think he's got so many back. He has to go this way. Yes. Oh my goodness. And all of a sudden, it's a different possibility. Look at this. Now he's begging for the six. Or an ace is also very good. Yeah. And?
Actually, Markus would prefer that that Russel enters with an ace to get some timing.
Yep. Okay, and? Pick and passage, yeah.
Oh, six. Huge yep. Six.
Oh, my goodness. And? What's going to happen next is the backgammon question. Is it going to be a freaky deaky gammon? Is it going to be a board collapsage? And
but even if Markus collapses the 6 points, there's lots of life in it.
Yeah, I agree. But it's teetering in the balance with where's it going to go after this? Yeah. Okay, there's one in. Can he get the six? No. And? Ooh.
A nice shot. And
also it's very nice shot. Now we've got more excitement. And can he pop another six? No, he cannot. So I would stay on the 13.
Actually don't know. I really would like to have some hits, but...
I like it like this because he's got to come in and, yeah. So now he might get a, oh, now he's got to stay there again. Doesn't want to give the double shot. Oh, he does give it. Okay. Why not?
Okay. Giving the indirects, I think.
I would. Oh. Even if XG says it's wrong or GNU, I would do indirect, I think. It's just too big.
What does it say he should play? Give the 20 directs or 20 something directs.
Wow. Yeah. Okay, that's a miss up. Nothing covered, but ready in the outfield. And oh my, so go get back from whence you came. All right, and any more? And we can see that Markus is in danger of comfortably winning the ace point, deuce point stacking game. Yeah, there's the five board. And it's going to need a lot of luck here to get out of this one.
Up like this, it's difficult.
Very difficult. But
14 and 5? Is that it?
It's a tough one, isn't it, really? Because you would like to have some control of the outfield as well. Maybe this is good too. So you've got two. Yeah, why not? Obviously hitting. Yeah. Closer. Yeah. And there's the closeout. Okay. So that does make things a lot more interesting if Joe can see this through. It can only be 15 to 16, right at the business end of the match. And I think he's favourite to create that situation. Should be comfortable here with the bear off. More confident with the gap on 6 and 5 on the other side. Feel good factor when you're bearing off. Weakness in the opponent's home board. Yes. Okay. Yeah, two off. And, yeah. Just wins the game, and that's the end of it. Or should be the end of it, I should say. Yeah, going to have just a few too many off. Tough to catch up. end. Anything else interesting? No. And Jen Lazaro, what do you think now with world champion Russel fighting back?
I was prepared for this because Joe is never gives up, so it is completely normal. What surprises me, it's they are playing a bit fast for me. So I think that some mistakes were for this reason, but they are improving their level quite a lot.
I agree with you, Jan Lazaro, and maybe there's a few natural or unnatural twitches here and there. I think they both sense the importance of this next phase and want to get themselves in the best position to push forward and win the match. And what do you think as well, Jakob? Do you think we're going to see a bit more excitement in the culmination in the later stages of this match?
I think it has been exciting so far, but now we are moving into a difficult cube territory. So I still, even though I shouldn't hope for it, I still hope that I'm winning the 9.5 game here. It looks good so far. They need lots of good play in the last games to get it down to 4.05, both of them. But let's have a look. It has been an exciting match, I think.
Very exciting.
I mean,
and there's more to come. Yeah.
10-7, perhaps?
Yep. Okay. And better board for Joe, but good potential for Markus.
So are we hitting double or making the nine here?
I don't know.
Making the nine, the outside primes, but
it's too dangerous, though, isn't it? If you get hit on 13, you're so separated. I don't know. It's tough.
XG, Gnu definitely prefers making the nine.
Ah, okay. Yeah, tough call. I may have
Is this
blundered on that myself.
I doubt that.
Is this black doubling?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think so.
But nice shape.
Very nice shape. Three back, he's anchored, you're not really picking up. Yeah, I think it's too easy a decision, I think.
I'll make the five. Yeah. That's a permanent asset, and it just makes white's play so much more difficult.
It does.
I don't like it.
Yep. Let's see. Maybe.
This is just so nice.
It's so powerful. That is the warning to your opponent. Make one misstep. Gammon City. It's got to be that play. It's got to be the other one.
I think he plays the other one.
The difference, the psychological aspect.
Almost 200.
Yeah, even world champions don't always see things as they should. And the power of the wheel is just too much to say no to. It's an upgrade on the rack that's just so powerful. You've got to do it. Now he's going to be moving around all the time to try and make the four that he could have made then.
Are we just making the 8 point here?
I think we have to.
So we might as well.
I think we have to, Jakob. We're in danger. We've just got to wait, hope we can get at least one checker off the 23 and see where things lie. That's a good release. Yeah, I don't think so. I would release here. I think that's more important than the blitz. This kid's dangerous.
This is a difficult play, I think.
I like it like this because you're covering the fragile mid and the fleeing straggler, which is what you want. So something has to break if he doesn't hit.
I would make the five.
I would make the five too. I think this is taking away from the position. You may struggle after that. And I might do it again on the other side as well. Oh, the alternative is not so good. One and then play behind, or three and then... Mind you, this is not bad. Maybe a bit too aggressive for me, making the five and leaving double hits. Yeah. And? Want to try?
Clearing while we can.
Yes. I think it's a good time to do it. You got such a good racing lead. Very little risk there. And it bodes well for your game plan. You'd love to try and fill in the five. So this, all roads lead to increasing that possibility. How thinking about it.
Making the ace, is that right?
I think ace, yeah, ace is good.
This looks
I think it's so better the other way.
You get
rid of the dilly and now you've got your three activated spares exactly where you want them to be. Yep. The other way. Ooh.
Oh, this is also a difficult play. You'll probably stay, but it sort of crushes. You can also stay with one check, of course.
Staying with one checker, probably.
Yeah.
One, two, just have three, the timing four. To stay with both or this.
You can move out.
Yeah, this is a good one.
Well done. I think this is so anti-instinct. Oh. Oh my goodness, look at this.
Back to the previous round where Duckfin wrote 65s and 4s and then 3s and aces and Ryan got the deuces.
Yeah, that's right. I think I remember the Sonic Boom at the time. Sonic Boom!
We have a new match, favorite.
We do indeed.
But only small, but still.
Still enough. Yeah.
What's
no force this time.
Yeah, he needs to try and fit in that 4 point to assist in giving him more chances to win this game. Would he find it? Would he get it?
6-5, maybe?
Yeah, I think. Yeah, I played that too.
Yeah.
And perhaps both to the 4 point.
Yes.
That might be.
No, to the 4, man. Come on. You need the 4s. This is rudimentary, dear Watson. No. Now you roll 1-4, every 4 after that you start dumping. This is absolute basics. I would have been very disappointed with a player of Marcus's class if he didn't find that one. Not a difficult concept.
Oh, nice.
Very nice. Okay. Are we going to get some excitement at the end here? Oh, it's building up. Oh, end of that. Yeah, forget that.
No longer.
Boring.
Yes, boring. Okay.
Well, at least Markus got his double force.
He did. What do you think, Jan Lazaro? Who's going to win? Is it going to be Markus or is it going to be Joe?
I see little favorite Joe.
Ah, okay. All right. Bojo?
If you ask me, Jakub is going to win.
Ah, okay.
Because they're not going to get under 9.5.
Yes. Good retort. Oh,
this is three back.
Too much.
Yeah, okay. But we are
getting closer. Oh my goodness.
But now?
Now you've got to fire, surely.
Four way. You need to fire.
You've got to fire the bullet, surely. You can't
three
wait.
Back and another
should take.
I don't care about the three back. I've got two on the roof. I'm shooting at another one. All I see is the gammon.
Can he take?
I don't know.
I don't know, but it's a tougher decision.
I think it is a drop.
Four away.
Yeah, I'd probably drop it. I don't really like playing with two on the roof and no.
Maybe three on the roof.
You got to drop. But you've got to send a cube first. Unless he thinks it's too good here.
Eight in the zone. Ace point slotted, so this is really bad, but it's far away.
Yeah, that's the question. It's the value of what's happening overall.
That's a complicated position.
It is.
And he rolled.
I don't think it's too good.
I don't think it's too good as well, but...
Now it is, if he dances again.
Yeah.
He didn't, but even so, he's not going to take this now.
No.
That's the problem. You have to ask the question when it's still takeable. You want double take. That's where all the equity is in backgammon.
I think that now it is too good.
I agree with Jan Lazaro.
I would still cash here.
Yeah, I think it's dangerous. And it's the
kind of... annoying to be hit here, of course. But
it is.
That could be the price.
Yeah. Okay.
This is an interesting case.
Ooh!
Yeah, and now look at the difference. Now we could get reverse pressure. Now the moment has passed. Now the course of the game is moving in a different direction. And this is the downside of when you don't pick your moments and take your chance.
But it might have been right to play on too good, but...
Yeah.
This is what happens, but...
Yeah, but I think the one before the play on, there was a good chance to ask the question then.
Welcome back.
Oh, he's anchored. Oh, and he sent it back. Oh, my. What great dice you
have. Now it's definitely too good.
Now it's too
good. Just the other way.
This is definitely too good, yes.
No. Come on.
Okay.
No.
There was a missed double before.
For the double force.
Before the double force.
Very beginning.
Double pass.
And now after that, it has been correct to play too good. Play for a gammon.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but now we've got double-edged excitement. They're both four away. Oh, this is troubles. And I think this is closer to too good than double pass.
Probably too good.
I think it is.
Too good.
Yeah, the chance there. Yeah.
Congratulations, Jakob. You have 1 point in the pocket.
for I'm rich.
Yeah, indeed. Yes. Very rich.
Karmatikus Fili, Elias Kritikus, Peter Van Roy, Ido Levy, Daniel Sjorensen, Marcus Reinhardt, Rory Pascar, Daniel Zakhariev, and Zlatina Petrova. They all predicted over 9.5, and it looks very likely that they are gonna get the points.
Does look that way at the moment, doesn't it? Yes. And we move into the business end of the match. Every decision amplified, more at stake. Everything ramped up. Do you have what it takes to see it through to the end? Step over that line with aplomb. Good decision making, taking your moments. What will happen next? That's the question.
Okay, we have a message in the chat by Bakar Matikashvili, one of our good friends. He says, nice match and fantastic special guest. Jakub, he says, is in my top five players ever. Thank you, Bakar.
Thank you, Bakar.
Thank you, Bakar.
Well. Yeah, he just, this man knows backgammon inside out, and that's a wonderful compliment to the majestic form of the Viking Grandmaster Jakob Rasmussen. Superb. Just what we like to hear and see. Positivity in the highest regard. Wonderful.
So here he can choose between the double hit and playing safe to 14 and 9. Interesting choice.
I think the safer play, because you're ahead in race and this creates a beautiful position to play from. So I'm
that's what he did, and that's what Gnu agrees with.
Yes. And the small reward in leaping forward.
And here he needs more. He must cube.
Yeah, this is not a nice. This is a bad setup with the 4 and 7 or the 21 and 7.
Yeah, I like your vision, Bojo, and Jakob's insight. Look at this.
Still a correct take because of the contact.
And oh, nice. That, yes, but it's ramping up, isn't it? Now he's secured. Eight. Yes. 4-2-1.
Well, he wants to clear from the back, so.
Yeah, we're just moving. Making the
5
and moving to
8. Yeah.
Because if he rolls double fives, then he's going to clear first the 8 point, which is not that good.
Yes. Then a good think on it. Okay. He went for that one. My first thoughts.
Gnu agrees this is the best one. Well played, Eric.
Well, according to Gnu, I'll take my little moments while I can. Could be overruled in the higher court of appeals.
Done everything on 8 and hope not to roll 4s. Or too many 4s, at least.
Yeah, I think you're right here, Jakob. It's just too good a chance. Anything else?
And the other looks oddly stiff.
Double 4s leaves a shot.
But yeah, only once.
That's what happens.
You're more likely not to roll it and roll the deuce and the threes that give you all the additional 4s. So I think Jakob is right here. Because if you don't roll double 4 in the first shake and you roll any deuce or 3, then that's an additional 4.
I would play all to the 8, but yeah. I'm not
that's
sure.
That's my move. That's my move in a heartbeat.
No, we go from the 8, and yeah, it doesn't make any sense staying there.
That's right.
And this is the problem with the combined 22, 21, and 18 games is that it's only sort of a holding game anyway. So you can't play it as a back game.
Yes. Okay, very unlikely to be a gammon, but a good forge ahead potentially for Markus here. Really ramping up the contest right near the finishing line.
For sure, Joe is ready for action.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, I'd never count Joe out, regardless of what the PR says, how he is or where he is. He's got an indomitable spirit for these kind of contests.
Oh, that's a nice
show. It's a fantastic
good 3-6. Good 3-6. Yeah.
And we've witnessed it before.
Another good 3-6.
Wow. Look at
can
this.
Can he get another good 3-6?
This is well. Oh, are we playing safe or picking?
There is no safe play. What is safe play here?
You want the safe play?
No, but what is the safe play? I mean,
The safe ish is playing from the 6 point.
I would play from the 6, I think.
It's giving 2 more shots, but. He doesn't have the race lead enough.
Yeah, tough call, but yeah.
We play safe when it is safe.
Yeah. Have to call it, but
looking.
Just go all the way.
This is okay as well. You gotta, he's not gonna get G'd, so why not? Get a bit more juice on the 4.
No, it's
yeah, he's giving up the ghost.
The PR plays, but it doesn't really matter.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, PR.
I've noticed that XP doesn't care if you're playing something cute. If it understands that you are all, you will always be saving the gammon, then it doesn't give you any bonuses on the PR.
Ah. Oh, that's a good thing. That's a good thing. No rewards for artistic expression.
No.
Yeah.
Two away, three away, Markus Doeve.
Yes. But look, why don't I get extra? I'm doing synchronized diving here. I want an extra few mini points, please. Nope, sorry. Okay, he hits. Yeah, too many threats on the other side of improving.
Is it now the time for a nice back game?
Oh, there's no back game, but
there are.
Look at this. I see the gammons. Less now that he's rolled double threes, but it was looking bad before the double three for Jola.
Oops.
Wow.
9 point.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Now look at this. We have action.
This looks like by game, but not completely because of the anchor of the opponent on the 21.
It looks pretty.
Yes. Now, I would actually hold the six there just because I think it might give him awkward sixes elsewhere.
I think I'll make the eight, but... But it's stiff. You can also play in, of course. It looks a bit more flexible. Play to the four.
Yeah.
I also make the eight.
And it looks like Jakob is right. And Bojo.
And this is 7 and 3, yeah.
Yep.
Because when you stay on nine, you have bad aces, deuces, and sixes. While if you make the eight, half of the sixes are point making.
Oh, and here's the cube one. You can actually, if you hit and make the deuce point, then 3-6 forces you to go from the ace.
Yes.
Okay. It's not right, but still. what was right?
Wow, yeah.
Making the bar was right. Okay.
Oh, priming.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yes,
yeah, because you're two away. Where's the 1-3 plus your two away? You don't need to overpush to win just now. Just squeeze. Wow. All right. Maybe you could try and guarantee the point. And if you really get lucky, thanks very much.
You just go to 9 here. Everything else looks horrible.
This is the better play. Because you're getting hit with a 4. Getting hit with a 6 is a bonus.
And you're not getting hit with the 6s.
You're not going to get hit with the 6, so it's only the 4.
Yeah, doesn't want to open up the can of beans.
Finally, Markus made the bar.
Yeah.
And Joe made the bar, so everybody's going to the bar now.
And Joe's game is not too bad.
I'll have the margarita, please, Bojo.
And he's probably should he make the 4? It's annoying to be hit here and dance rather.
I like
it's also nice to get a checker free. I think I'll put a checker out. But
it's a close call. But there's something I'm seduced by the beauty of the.
About 6-5 giving a shot. I think you should just stick it up and slot.
I would go to 17, but I like making the 4 as well.
Yeah. Releasing the pressure valve is probably the best move, but there was something about that board that I found hard to resist.
Gnu goes for 17 as well.
Yeah. No surprise. Okay.
Clear the 9, I think. I would clear the 9.
What else can you do?
Yeah, you could start looking at clearing the 7 and moving something to the 2 point, but that doesn't look right.
You don't want to bring checkers to the 2 point when your opponent is playing a 24-22 back game.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, two gaps in front.
But you can't be seduced by clearing the most difficult point to clear.
Yeah, because you've got so many numbers that land without leaving shot. If you don't roll a number with 4 or 6 in it, you're in.
Is that the right four? No, doesn't matter. Probably.
So that's okay. An automatic play, and this is almost an automatic play. And now is the question. Gammon saved. This is not a bad start.
Oh, is that right? Do we run now? We do? That's
very nice. Close.
Nice shape.
Yeah.
Okay. And slot the deuce, and now start picking up one after another the black checkers.
Oh my, he has to break the 6 point. No choice, no other 3. Yeah. Will we see action?
There is nothing else to play, so the 3 is forced.
Yeah.
And then the deuce is easy.
Will he get it?
But is it enough to double?
Oh, there it is.
Should he have doubled? Yeah, I'm not quite sure on these positions. He would lose a lot of gammons missing anyways.
I would have waited there personally.
Yeah, I get Jakob's point, and I really don't know.
Here comes Mr. Sana.
I would have thought a bit more about the cube that Jakob told about. I think it was a double.
Oh, it's a very small double.
Okay. Borderline, right?
Yeah.
Wow. Well, it's nip and tuck. Oh, who's going to push? Who's gonna push the button? Oh, they're both
I think
playing.
If he had the 6 prime, it would have been a clear double. But before making the 6 prime, it's like not so certain.
Oh, the cube has been given and taken. So it's all on this now. Is that right?
This is correct in some instances, but...
Yeah.
Okay, we can definitely say that Jakub is the winner of the prediction game in the studio tonight.
By a huge margin.
Well done.
What's the race? You are actually probably... Are you making the 4? Are you jumping? What is happening here?
Well, you're ahead, so I like... Oh, this is pretty good too. I will just jump out.
Just jump.
You're ahead. Just jump.
And that's four. That's 8 numbers.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter. If you get missed there, you're so much better off. Yes, you did get hit, but it's the miss. The upside is very good.
So you're going into the 20 point and then playing 8 to 5?
Yeah.
Looks like a reasonable decision.
And getting a lot of shots against the straggler.
Yeah, and the race is kind of even, so this is going to end up, I think we're going to see more heartbreak and excitement here in the...
Come on. Not a, such this. A boring double match point without a single...
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Goodness. Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go.
At least this kind of excitement.
It's got to happen, isn't it? It's fireworks in the final game.
Well, as in round number 2, ladies and gentlemen, we have a double match point deciding the top match of the round.
Yes.
Another double.
I don't think it's going to be the last one either.
No, they are going to run fast until the very end.
Yep. Well played. I love this move from Markus, recognizing he has more option to fill in the 4. Oh, correction.
There is the next one.
Yes.
And this is also not going to be the last one. I bet on that.
Yeah, I agree with you.
This is how you win these tournaments, I see.
Putting it this way, both of them are ready to win it because both of them get double after double after double.
Yes. And?
So the defending champion or Markus Doeve from Germany. Who is going to get the win?
It. It's too close to call.
Come on, perfect. What happened with the fireworks?
Well, we could have another one here and there, but now they're making it more exciting by being closer to each other and nibbling a little bit here and there.
Well, Markus, big favorite now, if no fireworks.
Solid favorite.
Yeah.
John eats a double and a specific double. Instead, double for Markus. Not this one, John. Not this one.
I think that's it. I think that's too costly. That is it.
And we are going to have a new champion in Slavia Open 2024.
Yeah, indeed. And very well done to Markus Doeve. And commiserations to world champion Russel. And let's not waste any time. Jan Lazaro summary.
I think it was a very exciting match. I am a bit surprised because they ended the match with too many minutes on the clock. And I suppose that some decisions were too fast, at least for me. It's just my... But they played well. But I am sure they can play much better. But a good show. I think that viewers can be happy to have seen the match. So big congrats to both, and not see them in the next round. See Markus in the next round because Joe has lost. So congrats and good job.
Indeed. And Jakob, what were your thoughts overall about this exciting match?
I actually agree on it being played too fast on certain occasions where there were difficult decisions. Like they weren't seen at all, that they were possible. I think it was played at a brisk pace, and it was actually quite pleasant looking at, but I think they could have taken a bit more time on some of the crucial decisions.
Yeah, good point, I think.
But I think it's a danger playing online that you sort of gets up in pace. Your moving of the checkers when we play live, when you move the checkers, your brain often handles the decisions while you move the checkers, and here it goes too fast, so often you just play on automatic pilot, so to say.
Well, yes, what we're witnessing live in session is the classical example of tangible versus intangible interlinked with many other factors, which is natural and unnatural. It's unnatural to play online because you're not feeling the environment or touching the checkers or sensing what your opponent's going to do. So what happens in this regard is a lot more of your combative and instincts to what's going on are reduced because you don't get sent the signal through the ether. But when you play online, it becomes more the mechanism instead of the organism. And this is what we mustn't forget. I find personally that I struggle a lot more when I do play the occasional match online. It doesn't suit my style, one. And two, I just don't see things in the same manner. I don't get the same information from the static computer screen versus the backgammon board. Now, I'm not using that as an excuse. That's just what it is. I get much more feeling from the board, a live board, than I do from a computer screen.
I agree. I simply often don't really care enough, if it makes sense.
I do know what you mean. Yes. Yes. I think the way you explained it there is much better than my than the way I do as well. Yeah. But it's still a good challenge. and it gives a different dimension that is good to see. And Boja, what about yourself? What did you think overall about the match?
It was a nice, exciting match, and there were a couple of score turnarounds, what made it even more interesting. We had this double after double match point, which decided at the end in Markus's favor. Yeah, it was good. Of course, I'm a bit disappointed with the performance rating because my vote was for under, but this is a personal issue I have. And except for that, yeah, beautiful match. And I'm happy that another match that we do stream, it's ending up with in a double match point, which is always very exciting. And yeah, hopefully it will continue this way in the next crucial rounds.
Yes, fingers crossed that that will be what happens. And Jakob, being a man of vast experience and excellent play, what's your thoughts on a 21-point match?
I actually don't play too many of those. We play in Denmark, we play 17-point matches for our team tournaments, which is 25 rounds during the winter. So I'm a bit unaccustomed to it, but I think it has almost the same dynamics as the 17-point. There's often a lot of challenging decisions, getting very lopsided scores when you are, for example, 10 points ahead or something like that. So what should you take and what should you drop?
Yes. Yes. After you, Berger.
Sorry, Eric. I'm happy to welcome in the studio the winner of the tonight's match, Mr. Markus Doeve from Germany.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, Markus. Congrats.
Yeah, thank you. But we all saw it was luck. It was luck. It's fine. It's
fine. Oh, and I've just seen another well-known face appear in our little private studio. Welcome, world champion Russel.
Thank you. That wasn't my best effort. I just looked at the PR. That was pretty sick. I just played in a tournament qualifier for U.S. and I averaged a 2.5, and I got up in here in the mid-fives. That's pretty sick.
Yes, it can be world champion Russel, but we both know that this is normal. It's called an average. You've got more experience with the numbers than I do. If you add all those up, then add up the rest of your Slavia Open, I'm pretty sure you're going to be under five for all of those. The difference is, if we highlight one match and we don't play favorably, it always looks not so good. And I know, because I do it all the time. So I know what it's like, but that's why it's called an average. When you add the average up, it's not the same as the one output match. But it's human instinct. This is natural. It happens all the time in backgammon. And it's not to me to rain on your parade, of course. Well, you know, your caliber and class.
I don't play too many matches in the fives, so that's kind of disappointing.
Yeah.
But it was a fun match. It was a good match. It was an exciting match. And congratulations to my opponent for winning. A thriller could have gone either way at the end.
It could, and we weren't too sure in the live studio at the time what was going to happen, because there was a little bit of contact, and then you broke for the race, and then there was a few doubles and ins and outs, and I would imagine it came across very well on the stream.
I hope so.
Yeah.
I hope the people enjoyed the excitement of the match, if not the quality of the play.
Yeah, I think they will do. I mean, everyone's realistic. It's backgammon's going to be the winner, of course. I think the world knows how well both of you players can perform. Okay, you weren't on your A or B game, but that's normal, not unnatural or abnormal. It's just our individual expectancy changes how we see matches or view it, especially after the fact. And Markus, how about yourself? How do you feel about getting past the reigning champion?
Okay. Oh, I was not in the backgammon scene, so I didn't know it. I didn't know it. I know that it was a good player, and yet you don't make the stream for me. So, during the game, it was a 21-1 point match. That's a long journey. And yes, finally, the luck factor decided. And it was a human backgammon match. So there were several situations where I think, okay, XG would take the double, would give the double, but my feelings say, don't do it. And finally, I hear my feeling won, and the Pierre was not so good. But okay, it was a close match.
It was indeed, and as it was such a long match, we won't keep you for too long. So, Jakob, do you have a question for Markus or for Joe?
No, I don't think so. I think it was an exciting match and a pleasure to watch you battle it out. A bit fast played from time to time, but a nice match.
Okay, there was a clock, and it's the beginning of the match. We were a little bit behind in time, and at the end we played faster, and I realized that. Maybe we get a little bit tired.
Yeah, that's often the case, that you become tired late in the match. You can see your PR dwindling.
You can indeed. And Jan Nazaro, do you have a question for Joe or for Markus?
No, just my question was the one from Jakob, time handling that seemed a bit strange for me, but it was very safe in the sense that they didn't have problems with the clock. But it is a choice. But Markus already explained it.
Okay, and then over to you, Bojo. Do you have anything you'd like to ask Joe or Markus?
Yeah, I'd like to start with Joe. And Joe, even though you lost tonight, you remained one of the Slavia Open legends, and nobody can take this away from you. And my question is, are you going to participate in any of the major live tournaments this year?
I'm going to Sweden. I'm on the U.S. team in Sweden, and I'm going to Monaco. I'm going to travel in Europe for... My wife's going to join me at the end of Sweden, and we're going to travel through Europe for a couple of weeks, and then I'm going to Monaco.
That's nice.
We have a strong U.S. team this year.
Okay.
It's Victor and Bob Wattel and Steve Sachs and myself and Frank Talbot, David Klauser, Dana Nazarian.
Yeah, well, I think that's a good thing, Joe. It's been a little bit of time waiting for the USA to show some of their true class. So I think that's a positive move, and it's good to see. And it's good to see Victor.
Petco also, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's great to see Victor stepping into the Lions Den. And great to see Petco there. And now you've got a really good, fantastic squad. And there's many, many other players from the strength of USA backgammon. But at least you're starting your journey now. And I think it's important that the backgammon in the USA is too strong not to have at least this kind of representation. I mean, I could fire off five names immediately that would also be in the squad or can play. But for me...
The difference is that... We have so far to travel, usually, compared to the other countries, and to find, our strongest players who happen to be available at that time and are willing to travel that far is not always that easy. But with Sweden this year, it's like, it's like a lot of people have been to the Eastern Europe to play in these events before, but not many people have been to Sweden. So we got a lot of people who wanted to go to Sweden this year.
Good. I like it. And I do understand, of course, because we forget sometimes that the the jet lag and the hours of traveling plus the cost, it all does add up and does make a difference to the final decision. So I can understand that, of course.
I can. There were a couple of things in the match where I was like, regretted right after I did it. One of them was a pretty big error. One of them was a small error. The one time was when I rolled a 5-4 or 6-5 or something. I had six numbers to leave a shot, and he hit me with double threes and doubled me a couple of shakes later to a 4-cube. I had four checkers off, but I didn't have anybody on my ace point. And he still had a man outside. And I was thinking, well, he may not come in. He may not get a man off on this shake. And if I come in right away, which I did 30.5%, I'll be in pretty good shape. The problem was I didn't win that 30.5% when I came in. I couldn't recube him most of the time that I came in. And if I didn't come in, I was in really bad shape. That turned out to be like a 100 millipoint error. And the other one was an interesting position that I usually get right, and this time I didn't. It was in game 21, and it was move 8 for me. Can you guys see that position?
I'll have to ask, see if Bojo can just have a little look-see for us. I don't have anything in front of myself. If he can just have a little overview look and share that with us.
Then well, maybe John Lazaro can share it. I'm not able to.
No, but I mean, just with speaking, not
well,
with
the visual. I can tell you what the theme was. The theme,
which move? Move 8 or?
Move 8. Move 8, the double 2.
Ah, yes. I was not sure what I do. Do I go in the race or no? I was not sure, but my feeling
said
I'm not 5
points after the race. But the difference, if I make the 9 point, your men on the 18 point are 10 pips behind my men on the 13 point. So even though I'm up 5 pips, you really have 5 pips fewer timing. So I can, you know, I can play those men off the 8 and 9 and have a good chance of cracking you. It's a small error. It's 0.036. But that's, I mean, that, a lot of mistakes. I made 40 mistakes in the match or whatever it is. But there were two that I was really kind of sorry I did right after. And this one really cost me because you rolled a double 6 and won the game. Where if I had, you know, made the 9 point here, the double 6 would have been blocked. And I may or may not have won after that. I don't know. But the concept here is an interesting concept, is that you, a lot of times it looks like you might want to race because you're 5 pips ahead, but I'm actually putting more pressure on your men on the 18 point than you're putting on my men on the midpoint, because my checkers are 10 pips ahead of yours. So there's a fairly good chance you'll be forced off that point before I'm forced off the midpoint. And if I were to roll some other double, you know, then I could decide to race. And that was something I was kind of sorry I did right after I did it. There were two things I was sorry I did right after I did it, even before the result came out. One was taking that 4 cube, and the other one was this one. Yeah, there are 40 things I should have been sorry about, but these were the two that I was conscious of right after I did it and thought, you know, that probably wasn't right. I should have thought more about the 4 cube, because really what my first instinct was, well, he may not get a man off. And if I come in, I've got 4 men off, and I come in 30.5%, like I said. Yeah, but the problem was I didn't win that 30.5%. You know, I might win 18 or 20%, but I needed more. And if I danced, I was really in bad shape. So,
yeah, I think we talked about it quite well in the studio at the time, and there were a few differing opinions, and I'm pretty sure in your own time, and you go back and have a look at what you're saying, and then you can formulate in your own mind a bit more of your own thoughts and work things out from there, I think.
Yeah, well, I was almost, as soon as I took the cube, I thought, you know what, you've miscalculated that, because he didn't take a man off, which was good. Actually, he came in and didn't take a man off, and I had a really, you know, if I come in with a 6, I have a really good chance to win. But the problem is, I haven't won. I was viewing it almost if it's, you know, I was 80% if I came in or something, but I wasn't. I was maybe, you know, 65% or 70% if I came in.
So. Yes, and I think the presupposition is that you were leaning a bit more towards I'm coming in. But the other factor was what happens when you don't come in is the other side of the coin. And that's what tends to happen sometimes.
Well, I was in really good shape, buddy. I just didn't win enough when I came in. I didn't win the 80 or 85%. I was more like 70% when I came in.
Yeah. That was it. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Joe. I will have one more question to you just a bit later. So I would like now to go to Markus. Markus, first of all, you mentioned that you are not the reason for us to stream this match. And I would say that you are completely wrong. Because, of course, streaming Joe as a defending champion was very exciting, but we are always searching for the most exciting match where the opponents are more or less with equal skills. So definitely streaming your match against Joe was for us the top match for this for this round, and it was because of both of you. Now that you eliminated the champion, how are you? How do you consider your chances for winning the tournament?
Everyone wants to win it. When you started, everyone wants to win it, and I think everyone knows how to play the game more or less good. And it's only one match. It's only one match. So. A PR7 player can win against a PR2 player. Everything can happen. Let's see. I want to play on because the last years I always be out in the first two rounds when I remember it correct. So now I want to go a little bit for longer in this tournament. I want to stay long in this tournament.
Best of luck with that. And back to you, Joe. I have one question to you, which is not related to the tournament, but can you describe shortly what are your memories from the experience in the World Championship in 1989? Just most of us didn't play backgammon back then, and it would be nice if you share a little bit how it was, how did you feel, how was the tournament, and how did you celebrate the title after you won it?
Well, first, back in those days, if you could ask me if there's anything in the world I wanted, if I could have anything, it would be to win the world championship in backgammon.
Nice.
Because I was so addicted to backgammon at the time, and I'd been playing for about 10 years, and I loved the game, and I played. You know, 5 days a week or something like that. And it was the most important thing to me. That's what I wanted to do. If you said, you know, you could have $1 million or you could win the world championship, it would have been a tough choice. Back in those days, I think there were like 280 players in the event. So I had to win like 8 matches, and, the toughest opponent I played probably along the way was Billy Horan, and that was in the third match. But I played a lot of really strong players, and you know, the play in that day wasn't the same level it is today. Of the 8 players that I played, you know, there were probably, if I had to guess PRs, you know, there were probably, Billy Horan was one of the top players of the day. He played, you know, a lot of times he played. Even his older matches, you look at, and he played like, you know, 3 PRs, but he probably averaged, you know, in the mid 4s or something, or maybe high 4s, 5 even. I don't even know what he averaged, but he put in a lot of good PRs. But, you know, the average player back in those days probably played in the tournament, they probably played, you know, 10 or something like that. And there was a much greater difference between the good players and the average players. Like Monaco now, maybe the good players play in the high 2s and low 3s, and the bad players play in the 7s or 8s, you know. back in those days, the good players maybe played in the fours and fives, and the bad players played in the 20s, you know, or 15s or 16s. So it was a little bit easier field to win back in those days. But I had a pretty reasonably tough draw. I think I only drew one player that was pretty weak. And I think that was like maybe the fourth round or something like that. But anyway, it was very exciting for celebrating. To me, it was more of a relief than anything. It wasn't like, I went out to dinner with some friends and I picked up the dinner, but it wasn't like I didn't go crazy. It was kind of just like I've done it. It's fantastic. I'm happy. I was really happy, but it was more like, finally, I got this. I'm the world champion. I do know that going into the final match, I was playing Mika Ladov, who was the top female player in the world at the time. And she'd beaten a slew of the top European players, I mean, one after another. And she beat, I think, a couple of the Germans and a Dutch player. And they were in the top, 20 players in the world. She'd really been on a roll. And I was like, the bookmakers had me as like 13-10, I think 6-5. If you wanted to bet on me, you had to lay 13 to win 10. If you wanted to bet on her, you could bet 5 to win 6. And I had myself in the Calcutta. Funny thing, Louis de Jong, who was a great Calcutta auctioneer, read off the Calcutta. This was my third time to go to Monaco, and I wasn't that well known in Europe, and I was, pretty well known in the United States, but in Europe, not that many players knew who I was yet. And he read my name as on the Calcutta sheet, J. Russel. And he said, I don't know who this J. Russel is. It might be Jane Russell, the actress. And everybody laughed. Jane Russell was a famous American actress with very well endowed. And then he proceeded to buy me in the auction at a cheap price without ever mentioning my real name. And I bought myself back. And so going into the final, I had a nice piece of myself in the Calcutta, which the Calcuttas were Calcutta prize at the time. First place was more than the tournament prize. So it was a lot of money at stake. So anyway, I pretty much hedged in the final almost 50-50. I think I was going to make like, 5 or 10,000 more if I won the tournament than if I came in second. But to me, it was like winning was everything. If you could just say you win and you get nothing, or you get come in second and you get 100,000, I would have definitely won, because I knew that, this is something they can't take away from you. Once you're world champion, you're world champion. I can make $100,000, but you only get so many chances to be world champion. And being world champion did benefit me in many ways. I made many contacts from backgammon in business and so forth. And I'm sure that winning that world championship made me, in one way or another, has made me many times over the amount of money that I won. So that was an exciting and wonderful experience. And I think everyone should strive for that.
Nice story. Thank you very much. And respect for the point of view. Yeah, I think this is the correct approach. It's not the money, it's the title, because money we make other way, but the title in the world championship, that's the big thing. So respect, Joe.
Thank you.
All right. Any final question before I let the gentlemen go and enjoy the rest of their evenings?
By the way, when I played for the world championship the second time, I think it was 2016, against Jorgen Grandstedt, it was like, I think the difference between what he won and what I won was he got the board and I didn't. I think the money, we split it down the middle. So that's, again, it was like, of course, it's not as important to win it the second time as the first time. But, you know, everybody wants to win. That was his third win.
Yeah, I remember it. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. You guys do a fantastic job. The stream team is amazing, and I really appreciate you putting on this tournament. It's very, very well-run tournament with great commentary by the stream team, and it was a lot of fun to win it last year. I'm sorry I'm knocked out this year, but I had fun, and I thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, too.
Thank you, Joe, and see you in Stockholm.
Okay. Are you playing on the Italian team?
I am not sure because there are a lot of players better than me, but I'll go there at least to stream Italian team matches.
Fantastic. Well, I hope you end up playing.
Thank you.
All right. Adios, guys.
See you, Joe. Thanks a lot.
Adios.
Adios.
Congratulations again on your win.
Yes, well done to you, Markus, too.
Congratulations, Markus.
Okay, right. Thanks.
Take care. Jakob, anything before we let you depart as well?
No, it has been a pleasure joining you this evening. Thank you, and I'll be happy to do it again at a later time.
Fantastic. I think Boja will take care of that, and we very much enjoyed your insight and your natural humour and illumination of backgammon. So we look forward to having you in the studio with us again sometime soon.
Cheers.
Cheers.
See you guys. Have a nice Jakob.
See you, Jakob. Thanks.
Bye, Jakob.
See you in Stockholm. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
And anything for the Victor before we let him go as well? Okay, so I'll begin to wrap things up here. Oh, yes. Any final words, Jan Nazra, before I close out?
No, just another good choice, because another very, very interesting match. Was a big fight till the last last roll, so we can be satisfied about it, and I hope all viewers liked it.
Sure. And any final words, Boja, before I begin to close out?
Well, I would like to once again congratulate Markus for the win and for proceeding to the round number 4. And in that round, he's going to play the winner of the match, Mitko Keremetchev from North Macedonia versus Shane McNally from Australia. The two of them are playing tomorrow at 12 o'clock backgammon time or WBIF time. So let's see who is going to be Markus' opponent. And yeah, thank you for the exciting match, and best of luck in the next rounds.
Sounds good. Okay, commiserations to the match loser, or champion Joseph Russel from the USA. And congratulations to the match winner, Markus Doeve from Germany. And a big thank you to our special guest from Denmark, Grandmaster Jakob Rasmussen. Do keep an eye on Facebook and YouTube for further information and future presentations. And we look forward to welcoming you to more backgammon action with the stream team. And before we say toodaloo, food for thought. Mark Twain. The two most important days in your life are the day you are born and the day you find out why. Until we meet again, cheery bye.